Scientists are getting a better understanding of how crucial quality sleep is in forming memories. UC Riverside psychologist Sara Mednick has made what's being called a groundbreaking discovery on this link, which has been published in the Journal of Neuroscience. She joins me now. Welcome.
Hi, thanks very much.
You've made a critical discovery between brain activity during sleep and memory. What did you find?
Well, we knew that certain features of sleep are correlated with certain kinds of memory improvement, but what we didn't know is whether you could actually manipulate those features of sleep and see changes to memory. And what that would mean was that these sleep features were actually causally related to these memory improvement consolidation processes. So what we did is we used a very common drug, Ambien. It's a hypnotic that is one of the most common sleep drugs, and we gave it to people during daytime naps. And what we found is that their performance on a specific kind of memory improvement, memory task, improved. And when we looked at what was going on in the brain during those sleep periods, we found an increase in sleep spindles. Sleep spindles are a very short little active period of sleep which occurred during non-REM sleep. And we found that the sleep spindles were increased in the group that had the Ambien, and that was also the group that had the increase in verbal memory.
But there's no suggestion here for people who are having problems with their memory to go out and get a prescription to Ambien.
So we're not there yet, you know, because there's a lot of more research that needs to be done. It's not Ambien per se, but it is a possibility that we could actually start to think about how sleep could be tailored to improve certain kinds of memory deficits, because specifically, older adults, people with Alzheimer's, people with dementia, these are the people that start to have exactly this kind of memory deficit. So is it possible that we could use sleep to treat these memory deficits with pharmacology or some other means is kind of the direction I think these things are going.
So what's the next step in your research?
Well, we're trying to understand what the mechanism is. What is it about Ambien that is better than sleep itself? And we're also trying to see, well, can we start to use this particular drug in people with these kind of memory deficits to find hopefully some sort of improvement in their memory related that would be sort of either decreasing that that downward slope of memory decreases.
I want to switch gears right now to daylight savings time. We're in the second day of daylight savings, and this transition always seems to be a lot harder than when we go the other way. Is it just losing 1 hour of sleep that's so hard on the body?
It's a really surprising amount, right? It's because it seems to be, you know, on average we lose about 40 minutes of sleep, which you would think that shouldn't be that much. But the question is, it's not just the time of sleep, or the amount of sleep, it's the timing of the sleep. So we are driven by circadian rhythms, which tell us when we should be awake and when we should be asleep. And there's a problem there between what our natural timing should be during the day and what our social time is. And there's a group in Germany that's called this social jet lag, the difference between what your natural internal rhythm is and what your social requirements tell you to do, what time you need to be at work, when you need to be at class, when your child is waking up. And so the discrepancy between your internal clock and your social time is called social jet lag. And when we hit daylight savings, we actually have a massive shift in our social jet lag, and a recent study looked at social jet lag and showed that it increases, that it's correlated with increases in obesity and all sorts of other health problems. So this is, I think, the reason why it's so difficult to transition. It's not just the time amount of sleep, but it's the timing that we should be sleeping in.
So what can people do to adjust?
Well, one thing that I did is I just slept in today. And I know it's really difficult for a lot of people, but is there a way that they could, you know, talk to their bosses, talk to the schools and say, we need to transition more slowly. So, you know, can you sleep in 15 minutes? Can you sleep in 30 minutes? Can you just change a little bit just to transition through this week? Because as you know, when you travel to Europe, when you travel to New York, you have jet lag and it's really hard to wake up. Well, this is exactly the same thing. It's like traveling to Texas or something. So you want to sort of transition slowly through this period instead of having this abrupt shift.
Now, there is an effort underway to actually get rid of daylight savings time. What do you think of that idea?
I'm all for it. I actually, you know, I've been looking at the history of jet lag, of daylight savings, and I see that there was some economic reasons to do it. There was some reasons which we were trying to save energy. But now we've got so many different ways where we can save energy that I don't think the economic reasons really pay off for all the possible differences or decrements to our health. So I'm actually going to sign that petition that's gone to the White House.
Very quickly now, what do you consider a good night's sleep?
For me, the definition of a good night's sleep is when you wake up and you feel good. So that could be that you have to wake up at different times of the night. You know, so it's not about how much you sleep. It's not about when you sleep. It's what makes you feel like you've slept well. And you know, that can be any number of different things. So I don't ever think that I would never prescribe one kind of sleep for everybody.
Sara Mednick, thank you for coming in and talking to us today.
Thanks very much.